Good evening, brothers and sisters. I want to start by thanking everybody for taking the time out of your schedule to join us tonight. I would ask that everyone refrain from recording video or audio. We are going to run our own video of the two phases of the opening presentation. One will explain how we got to where we are. The other will explain what's in the agreement. When I get done with those two parts of the presentation, we'll open it up to all the questions and answers that you guys, or questions that you have to get you answers. So save your questions, make a note as to anything you want to talk about, but it's your meeting. Before I get underway, I want to introduce a few people that are here to join us tonight. One of the things that's unique in this bargaining round in my lifetime as a railroader, and I think for everyone else, John included, and the other senior officers of both unions, this is the first time that UTU, now SMART-TD, and BLE, now BLET, have bargained together nationally in my lifetime. For the first time ever, engineers and conductors will have the same agreement in front of them at the same time. And that, I think, is worth noting. It's been quite an accomplishment, I think, for the two unions to get together, stay together, show solidarity, along with the other four unions that are in our coalition. Here with us tonight from the Executive Committee of the BLET side, Lee Pruitt, our first Vice President, alternate President, Steve Bruno. Somewhere. Where's Steve?
Right here,
our National Secretary Treasurer. We have several officers of the BLET's advisory board here as well, and then you can meet with them, but I'll run through them if I can remember them all and see them. Gil Gore is here, Mike Priester, Rick Gibbons, where are you pointing? Jim Lewis, John Tolman, trustees Mark Wallace and Dave Estes. Did I leave anybody out that's here tonight? Thank you, guys. Also, we have Paul from the dispatchers organization. The ATDA is part of our coalition. John, would you like to introduce who you've got here from SMART-TD?
Sure.
John Lesniewski.
Sure. One of the people that I wanted to make sure that I got here tonight, simply because he is the general chairman that has jurisdiction over the entire northern half of CSX, and I wanted him to have to answer all the questions about the Hunter Harrison cartage rather than me, Steve Mavity back there. And I also noticed a couple of the local chairmen here from my days when I was general chairman of that property. Eric Kaczynski and Bob Kazar are both here. And, Doug Minipenny. Hey, Doug. Sorry. Yeah, I didn't see you back there, Doug. All right, and that's it. We have some staff people here. Our general counsel, Kevin Brodar, and Jeff Brandau is back there. But one of the things I did want to say, and I don't want to step on Dennis's presentation because I've seen it before, and he does a fantastic job of laying out not only the landscape of the negotiations, but the contract itself and the different options that are available to us with regards to our vote. But I did want to say that this truly was, you are taking part in history. Last week, I marked my 45th year on the railroad last week, and I have never seen where UTU and BLE sat down together, worked together in the same type of cooperative atmosphere as what we had during these negotiations. Not only our two organizations, but the other four as well. I made a lot of good friends during the course of these negotiations simply because we took the time to talk to each other and listen to what the other was saying. And this is history, so appreciate that. Thank you.
Thank you, John. Well, what I'm going to do first is just kind of lay out how we got from the beginning of negotiations to where we sit now. In December of 2014, the six unions that are in our bargaining group got together as part of the beginning of Section 6 bargaining. Under the Railway Labor Act, the parties serve notices, and that kicks off negotiations. At the beginning of the round, even preceding that, I had personally outreach to all 12 unions that are at the bargaining table in this round. We had invited all 12 unions to bargain as one group. In the end, the six unions that did bargain together agreed to do that. That's the BLET, SMART-TD, ATDA, the dispatchers, BRS, the signalmen, the firemen and oilers, which are part of the SEIU. They're the laborers in the shops, and the boilermakers. So we have a diverse coalition of operating employees, people out on the ballast via the BRS, and some shop crafts. Our coalition includes people that have the highest pay scale at the railroad all the way down to the lowest pay scale at the railroad. That group sat down with the railroads and started bargaining over what was in the notices that we served. There are questions out there as to what was in the notices. Most unions put those notices up on the website. BLET has those still up for anyone to review. Those notices were built in conjunction with our general committees based on the things that they wanted us to put on the table and bargain about. Every one of the items in those notices has been discussed with the railroads. So if anyone tells you we didn't ask for it correctly, that's not actually the case. Every item that's in those notices was discussed when we met with the railroads. As the round progressed, it became obvious that this round was hung up over health care. If anybody's paying attention, health care is a huge issue in this country right now. It is a huge cost, and quite honestly, until the government actually does something meaningful to control health care costs, we are going to continue to talk about health care. It's just that obvious. As the round progressed, the railroads demanded more and more out of your pocket. The only ways to change this dynamic, it's an experience-based health care plan. They take the total cost that come from you going to the doctors and the hospitals. They divide it by the number of actives. They add an administrative fee, and that is what sets the premium rate for your insurance plan. In 2016, that insurance rate was $1,525 per person per month. That is what the railroads pay for your health care benefit via that premium setting. As part of the last agreement, it was agreed that you would pay 15% of that number starting in 2016. That is where the $228.89 that you currently pay comes from. So not only was the railroad interested in making you pick up more cost when you go to the doctor, they were demanding that monthly contribution that you make continue to climb as well. It has been capped at $228.89 since 2016. Just to give you an example of what healthcare is doing in this country, from 2016 to 17, the price of that monthly premium went from 15 and a quarter to 1742. $217 increase per month per person for 130,000 active members. That's the kind of money we're talking when it comes to the issues that are on the table at the bargaining table. Had that number been used to set your current 228 at 15%, it would have gone up to 260 and some change. Currently, because we capped that in the last agreement, you are paying roughly 13% of the railroad's current payment rate. So I share that with you so you understand what the dynamic was of what drove these negotiations. As we entered in 2016, obviously an election year. And as we got closer to the election, it became obvious that the railroads were waiting to see who would win the presidential election because of the processes of the Railway Labor Act. And I think I can speak for every one of the unions that was at our table anyway. Regardless of how you voted politically, when Donald Trump won, the railroad's attitude changed dramatically. And here's why. Under the steps of the Railway Labor Act, you serve notices to bargain. That's Section 6 governs all this. If the parties cannot reach an agreement, they must enroll in mediation. The railroads took such a turn to the negative in the fall of 2016 that all six of our unions requested mediation from the National Mediation Board. You have to understand the National Mediation Board to really understand the impact of the process. The Mediation Board is a three-person agency, government agency, controlled by the administration and the White House politically. In the Obama administration, that was two Democrats, one Republican running the National Mediation Board. That was its structure when we invoked mediation. Shortly after that, in 2017, where the railroads continued to take a hard line, the one Republican at the Mediation Board resigned and went to work in another government agency. That left two Democrats. At about the same time, Donald Trump appointed two Republicans to take control of the National Mediation Board. This is important to you because the Mediation Board not only facilitates our mediation process, they're the people that decide when we have reached impasse. They're the ones that manage the process if we do reach impasse. They're the ones that would coordinate a presidential emergency board should any union go that route. As we began to bargain in the spring of this year, we actually requested that a board member join our negotiations to try to motivate the railroads to get off of dead center. Last spring, most of you saw proposals that the railroads gave us. They called it a new table position, an industry position, and it laid out some pretty onerous changes to the healthcare plan, some low wages. They attempted to take retroactivity off of the table. It was a proposal we could not present to the members because we knew you would not vote for it. It was dead on arrival. We published that so everybody would know what their table position is should we fail to reach a voluntary agreement. Here's how the process now stands and how it's now situated. If the parties cannot reach a voluntary agreement at a certain point, the mediation board will decide when you are at impasse. For example, on the maintenance away side, they have said that there will be no more bargaining. They have declared impasse. The government has not confirmed that, but the mediation board will now consider their request to be released from mediation. If you don't reach a voluntary agreement, the way that process works is that the mediation board puts forward what's called a proffer of arbitration. For those of you that were here in 1985, BLE accepted that proffer of arbitration to settle that national contract. That led to arbitration award 458. And for a lot of the old gray-haired guys in the room, that wasn't our favorite agreement. That was a government-sponsored contract that we did not enjoy the outcome of. On our side, our union promptly changed its bylaws to where no president can accept a proffer of arbitration. The reason, I think, being because it takes away your rights to self-help. It says that the arbitrator will settle your contract. It's binding. There's no recourse. It just ends it right there. So our union has not accepted a proffer of arbitration in 31 years since that happened. I don't intend to be the first. I've already notified the railroads that if we do not reach a voluntary agreement, we will reject that proffer of arbitration. Under the Railway Labor Act, if either party, the union or the railroads, reject the proffer of arbitration, you start a 30-day cooling off period. At the point that that 30-day cooling off period is expired, both parties have the right to self-help. From the union side, that could be a strike, it could be a slowdown, it could be railroad-specific, location-specific, craft or class of service specific, and every union that's similarly positioned could do that at the same time. From the railroad perspective, they gain rights to self-help. The railroads in the past have locked us out to try to move things forward. I think in 1971, they promulgated the rules, they called it. It's the one time under the Railway Labor Act where a railroad can impose changes to your contract without your consent or without a ratified or imposed contract. Both parties reach that point at the 30-day mark with one exception. And that exception is that the President of the United States can step in, appoint a presidential emergency board, and you lose the rights to self-help until the rest of that process is completed. That's called a PEB, Presidential Emergency Board. Again, it is managed by the National Mediation Board. November 1st, last week, the two Republican nominees to take over the National Mediation Board were confirmed. One remaining Democrat, Linda Pachala. So we now have a what I will call a corporate-friendly National Mediation Board poised to handle the process for the unions that do not complete the ratification process and come to a voluntary conclusion. The railroads have made it very clear, and it's just the way the round has transpired, that there is no table to return to. You can't compel either side. Maintenance Away said they're not going to bargain. The railroads can refuse to bargain. They can tell the mediation board, release us, we're done, make the proffer. The railroads have made it clear if we do not ratify, or if any union doesn't ratify, even those that have not got an agreement out, they will seek to be released by the mediation board to pursue the PEB process. There are no restrictions on the President of the United States as to who he puts on the PEB. None. He can put former CEOs. He can put family members. He does that a lot. He can do anything he wants when it comes to who he puts on this panel. If you look at some of the recent appointments, he has appointed the former CEO of Conrail to run FRA. The guy he's nominated to be in charge of mine safety is a former CEO of a mining company. So there is concern over who he would put on that panel. Once that panel is convened, it would hear the dispute from all the unions and the dispute from the company. The railroads have also made it clear that if we go that route, the proposal they will put on the table to the panel is not the one you're voting on. It is the proposal they put forward last spring. When we get into the presentation with the slides, we'll show you the difference between these two. And the best way to look at these slides is to understand the risk that you have with a no vote. It's that simple. Take the emotion out, just look at the dollar values. This is what we have if we ratify. This is what we put at risk if we go to a PEB. We don't share this with you out of any sense of fear. This is a reality-based assessment of where we are situated under the Railway Labor Act. Once the panel makes its recommendations, they, unlike arbitration, they are not binding. either party can reject the panel's recommendations. In 1991, for those of you that were around, PEB 219, appointed by Bush Sr., those recommendations were so horrible for us that we refused to put them out for a vote. We struck on April, I think, the 17th, and I think by noon the next day, Congress had imposed that panel's recommendations. After that 30-day cooling-off period, after the panel recommendations come out, you again reach the right of self-help. At the point you get to that level, you have exhausted the steps of the Railway Labor Act. The only people that can intervene at that point are the U.S. Congress, and they do not convene under the Railway Labor Act. They take over under the Commerce Clause of the United States Constitution. We'll show you the language that they used in 1991 when they imposed a contract on all of the unions that are here today. So it's important to understand exactly where we're situated in the negotiating process. There are people that are out there campaigning, trying to tell our members to vote no. They're telling our members to vote no, join them, we'll get you more. What they're not telling you is where they would go to get more. As I said at the beginning, guys, this has never been a failure to ask for more. This has been a very difficult negotiation. There have been changes in the operations of the railroads, especially you, those of you that work for CSX. We've had a downturn in business in the middle of the negotiating round. Obviously, they're making money. That's not the issue right now. But the railroads are poised to make an argument that the less attractive deal is what you should get if you go before a government to settle your contract. And we have to talk about what the government is up to right now. Right now, you have a Congress. If it were to go to them, Congress would have the authority to impose the panel's recommendation. They would also have the authority to write your contract themselves. They can do anything they want. It's called an act of Congress. They could dabble into things that you consider near and dear. This Congress has already made an overture towards railroad retirement once through Ryan. They have the authority to take you out of railroad retirement and put you into Social Security. They could take you out of FELA and put you in workers' comp. All of these issues become available to Congress, including right-to-work legislation. As of today, there are 100 Republican sponsors in the House for national right to work. We are currently exempt. If that was to come on the table as part of this, it would basically destroy the union movement and the railroad industry over time because it would allow people to not pay dues but obligate the union to still represent them for free. These laws are intended to have unions collapse under their own financial obligations for lack of members paying dues, and it's working across the country. So when you talk about a congressional settlement, do you want Congress to write your contract? Let's talk about some of the things they've done. They've put forward a budget that would cut $500 billion from Medicare. Every one of you has been paying into Medicare. Every one of you is counting on Medicare when you retire. That is your health care program. If they don't care what your level of health care is when you turn 65, do you think they care what it is when you're working? This same Congress defunded the CHIPS program, took away health care insurance from 9 million kids. Every one of their replace and repeal legislations would eliminate health care for 20 to 30 million people. This budget that they're putting forward is also rumored to have a trillion-dollar cut to Medicaid, which is how the elderly get their rest home care. Is this the group you want to put a health care dispute in front of? I would say that going to this Congress for the health care dispute is much like General George Custer running up to Little Bighorn twice, knowing who was up there. It doesn't make sense to us, guys. That's why at the point that we had got every crumb off the table, the wage teams of the six unions at the table agreed to let the membership decide. And I will never apologize for giving BLET's members a vote, and I know John Prevasich feels the same way, and the other presidents of the other four unions. Democracy says you guys should decide. Democracy says the membership should have a say in their own future. Not every union out there is giving its members this choice. One in particular is demanding a government contract. Maintenance Away is demanding that the government settle its contract through the PEB process. They've even said, we may lose, but we fought the longest. I'm more about the outcome than I am who fought the longest, guys. We need to protect our interests, and we need to make sure that we do not harm ourselves at this point in time with the government that we're dealing with. Regardless of how your politics are, if anybody thinks this Congress has been doing much for working class Americans, you'd have to show me where. We haven't seen it. If you want to argue that the wages aren't high enough, this is a Congress that won't raise the minimum wage because of corporate influence. when they're raising their or taking the money out of Medicare and Medicaid, it's to give a tax break of the equal value to the one percenters, the billionaires, the millionaires, the same people that run your railroads. So if they're going to give them a tax break and take away your health care over 65, why would we expect that they would take money out of their pocket while you're working and put it in your health care plan? So those are the decisions that all these wage teams had to consider as we decided to let the membership vote. What I'm going to do now is we're going to jump into the actual agreement and go over what is in it and what is not, and then we'll open it up to some questions.
Can I make one more comment too? One of the other things that you want to remember, too, is if we were to decide to go the route that the BMWE is and decide that we were going to take it all the way to Congress, is those very people that you're asking to rule on your health care, the people that are working for them are paying about 25% of their health care costs. So for them to be sympathetic towards our cause is just simply not realistic. And that's the point I wanted to make.
Okay. Thanks, John. Mm-hmm. The first thing, guys, we're going to talk about is the wages. There has been some speculation or some assertions by others that the 3% raise that was in the last national agreement is not part of this agreement, and that is patently false. There is a side letter in the BLET agreement. There's a side letter in the maintenance away agreement, the Smart TD agreement, that clearly states, should the parties have to put this dispute in front of a PEB, the January 1 of 2015 3% raise will be considered the full wage value for the first year of this contract, which is 2015. Normally, wage increases under national agreements are on a July 1 cycle. This one was not, the others aren't late, this one was early. It was paid as part of a carryover from the last agreement, but the 3% wage increase that you are already enjoying has already been paid as part of this contract period because it runs from January 1 of 15 to December 31st of 2019. What we will be confronted with if we go to the PEB is in the left column. That is the last NCCC proposal. They're offering the first two wage increases of 2%, but note that they add implementation next to it. That is to beat you out of back pay. Their new position is that if this has to go the government route, they will argue that you're not entitled to retroactive application of those two wage increases, one in 16 and one that should have been in 17. There are presidential emergency boards out there that have ruled against the unions, both BLET and Smart TD. On SEPTA, there are PEBs that ruled against the argument for retroactivity. Those guys did not get back pay. That creates a world where you lose bargaining leverage going forward because every day that you don't settle is a day that you lose money. So we were not inclined to put the question of retroactivity in front of a government panel. Our proposal has 2% July 1 of 16 with full back pay to that point and an additional 2% July 1 of 17 with back pay going back to July of this year. In July 1 of 18, 2.5%. You'll see theirs was 2. And in July 1 of 19, they were offering 2. Ours is 3. Their proposal in full was 11% over 5 years. Ours is 12.5%. If you compound the application by applying one wage increase on top of the others, the actual impact to your pay rates would be 13.14% over a 5-year period. Here's the important part about how this would be implemented. On or about January 1, go back one screen, Tom. On about January 1 of 2018, you would see the first raise that's retroactive July 1 of 16 on your rates. You would then see a second one added. Those two 2% raise applications, if applied with compounding, are worth about 4.1 to the working rate, and that's on January 1. So first day out of the chute, a 4% plus wage increase. 6 months later, another 2.5%. A year later, another 3%. That is 9.5% in 18 months. There is money in this deal, and that's where I think there's been some misrepresentations that the money's not rich enough in the deal. We're talking about a roughly with compounding 9.84% increase in an 18-month period to today's pay rates if this is adopted. Go to the next one. The other big issue on the table is that monthly contribution that I talked about earlier. It was built at $228.89 based on the payment rate in 2016 of 15.25. If we go the PEB route, the carrier's position will be that it goes up to $245 on July 1 of 17, which is about 4 months ago. It would go up to $260 July 1 of 18. It would go up to $275 July 1 of 19. The proposal you're voting on freezes it at 228 until the next contract is resolved. It's not the life of this deal. It's until a new contract would change it. All references to a 15% payment by the employees is removed. And if the premium continues to climb at traditional rates, in all likelihood, you would be paying around 10% of the monthly premium that the railroads pay by the end of this contract. So it's important to note that just in the next 2 years, that's worth $843 roughly to every working person, all 130,000 that are in the plan, if the whole plan adopts this. The 85,000 members that are represented by our six unions would all enjoy that frozen monthly contribution if this ratifies. The one other thing to note, if we go PEB, they are arguing the 245 retroactively. So on the one hand, they're saying you don't get back pay, but you do owe them money going back to July 1 of 17. You got to understand all the tricks they're playing here, guys, all the things they're going to try to get a government panel to give them out of your pocket. It's ludicrous, but we don't know what this panel might do, and we don't know what Congress would do with that panel's recommendations. The next screen, we're going to talk about the amount of money that's actually in the deal. We've built some screens here that are based on an increasable amount. Because when trip rates were created in 2003, there were some frozen monies in there. As the trip rate goes up over time, the percentage obviously gets smaller and smaller of what's left that's frozen. So you can't just say that my entire trip rate would get this wage increase. So the $50,000 with the asterisk in this example is built on increasable money. So because we've got people of all ends of the scale in our coalition at $50,000, if you look at the two red numbers, that's because those would not be applied until implementation, speculating on a January 1 implementation. If you go down to the net GWI value over the life of the agreement, you'll see the difference between the two numbers using what's in our agreement compared to what would be proposed to a PEB. If you go down and you add the 843 back in, the bottom right corner, if you're making $50,000 in increasable money, you are putting $3,592 at risk to go to a PEB, is the best way to look at that. I'd recommend you put it on a roulette wheel. I think your odds might be a little bit better than the government. If you move up to a $75,000 base, the difference between the two is almost $5,000 that would be at risk to go to a PEB, and that is in the next 2 years alone. That is just the life of the deal difference between our proposal and the PEB proposal. If you go back, Tom, if you go back and you look at the net GWI value over the life, those four wage increases applied in 18 months' time in 2 years to a guy making $75,000 will generate $13,596 additional dollars in income in 2 years' time. $13,500. If you go to the $100,000 model, and we have a lot of employees in this bracket, the total difference is $6,342 that you're putting at risk. But there is $18,000 in new money in this contract in a two-year period. That more than keeps up with the cost of living. It more than keeps up with any cost in the increase in health care. And if anybody's told you that it's not, they're not actually looking at the math. We actually have people at the $125,000. We have higher, but the $125,000 was the top one we put in here. At that level, you're putting $7,700 at risk to go to a PEB. And your additional money in 2 years' time, if this ratifies, is $22,661. When you look at how this would be applied, retroactivity would be paid within 60 days of an effective date of the agreement, which means a back paycheck would show up, 2% going back to 16, another 2% on top of that starting in 17, July 1 of 17. On a $100,000 base, that is roughly a $4,000 back paycheck that would show up about the time your Christmas card credit card bill shows up. So there is back pay. There is also additional money. That $18,000 on that model, $4,000 of that would come immediately in the form of back pay. The railroads have committed that they would apply the new rates and applying these wage increases on or about January 1 as soon as they can, depending on the railroad. But this gets you making more money by the first of the year, with back pay shortly after. We'll go to the next one, Tom. I think that one is the same screen, just a different way. Let's go to health and welfare, guys. The first piece will go back to the monthly contribution. It is frozen. There is no increase. This is one of those deals that it's important to understand what's not in the deal. There is no increase in your monthly contribution, and that is huge. you do the math, $843 times 130,000 active members in our healthcare plan. That's the amount of savings that one issue is worth. There are improvements to the healthcare plan, and we're going to go through those quite quickly. On the medical side, with no co-pays, no co-insurance, they have added expert second opinions. This one's important to me because I lost my mother this year to cancer. She was in the Medicare system, and they don't have second opinions. And there is some speculation that you live longer when you have access to that. And this would give it to you with no copay, no co-insurance. It includes, and these are all voluntary, it includes member advocacy services, end-of-life counseling. And we have added something that we've been long trying to get for operating crew members, and that's telemedicine. That allows you to get treatment for certain ailments without having to take an $800 trip off and go to a doctor. You don't have to go to a brick-and-mortar facility. You don't have to get charged with an attendance violation just to get medical treatment. You can do it over the phone. That would come with a $10 copay, much like the convenient care clinic. We have also expanded the Centers of Excellence benefit. We could do a better job of getting the word out on how these work, but a center of excellence gives you superior treatment and superior pricing if you have that in your plan. They've agreed to add the Cleveland Clinic's system for specialized cardiac care. If you use a center of excellence, there is no co-insurance. There is no deductible. There's no copay. And it even comes with a lodging and a travel allotment to help you get to those facilities to get this superior treatment. I was with a local chairman on the Santa Fe committee last week out in San Diego who is on his second kidney transplant. And the bariatric coverage, or is that the one that would cover kidney or the renal? Renal failure has centers of excellence already in the plan. He got both transplants for free because of this centers of excellence piece. So adding the Cleveland Clinic for heart care is a big addition to the plan. We have also improved the vision plan. Currently, you have to wait 12 months to get an exam. This would make it to where you could get one every year, so you could go in December and January. You wouldn't have to wait the full 12 months. The frame benefit has changed. Frame lenses to do the same thing every second calendar year instead of every 24 months. The flexible spending account is improved. This is a good way for you to pay your costs associated with any healthcare benefit. This would suspend the right for them to drop our FSA for lack of participation. We currently just wrapped up enrollment this year. I haven't heard what our numbers are, if we met the threshold, but currently it's 7.5% have to participate or they can yank it out from underneath us. This would take that requirement out. To ease people's concern that if you don't use it, you lose it, it would also give you an additional 10-week grace period the following year to spend that FSA money. That's not to file a claim. That's to go to the doctor for another 10 weeks to get access to those funds. And beginning in 19, it would raise to $3,000 from the $2,600 level it's at right now that you could set aside. This basically gives you access to tax-free money to pay your medical bills. A third of that money would already be going to Uncle Sam in taxes. It lets you keep it and spend it on medical. They have also agreed to combine the out-of-pocket maximums and deductibles for mental health substance abuse services. And I think this one in the age of the opioid crisis is critical. Currently, you pay two different sets of deductibles and co-insurance if you go through mental health substance abuse and then go to the doctor for regular services. This would combine those, and you would run the clock on a single clock, no matter which side of that treatment you went to. The final one on this, I think, should be in bolder print, and it has to do with the Cadillac tax. Every effort to repeal and replace the Cadillac tax by this Congress, or the Affordable Care Act by this Congress, has left the Cadillac tax in place. And that is an excise tax on certain health care plans if your value exceeds a certain monthly contribution level or annual contribution level. The railroads from the beginning said that if the Cadillac tax applied, it should be on you, not them. As it stands today without change, because they are the plan sponsor, it goes on them. They wanted it to go on you should it kick in. Right now it's suspended until 2020, but it could become a factor at that point. They also argued that they should have the right to reduce your benefits if we came under the Cadillac tax to avoid the tax kicking in by lowering your benefits, lowering the cost. That is off the table if we ratify this. If the Cadillac tax kicks in, they have to pay it. We are off the hook on the Cadillac tax if we ratify. If we go before a PEB, they have made it crystal clear. They will argue that they should not have to pay that tax and that you should. So this is one of those items that's not in the agreement, that's critical that you know that is not in the agreement. When it comes to the the actual plan values. You have to separate your monthly contribution for who pays for the medical treatment at what we call the point of service. In other words, when you go to the doctor. When we did the last agreement, there were slight changes in the point of service costs through the co-pays, deductibles, and co-insurance. When the dust settled, the railroads or the plan were paying 91% on average of your cost. That's an average of that 131,000, 130,000 active, 411,000 with dependents. They take all those costs. They see what you paid when you went. They monitor the amount that they paid. At the end of the last agreement, they were paying 91% of those costs. Over time, because the costs go up and your co-pays are fixed, your deductibles are fixed, that has crept back up to where it will be at 93.5% on January 1 of 18. And that is the issue that we were bargaining over, is what level should they pay and what level should you pay at point of service. The tentative agreement resets that at 90%. We're going to get into how that's accomplished with you picking up additional cost at point of service. If there is a negative to this agreement, this is it. But here's what this agreement maintains. It maintains their obligation to pay 90% of your cost. If we go to a presidential emergency board, they will argue that they should only have to pay 85. And the difference between an 85% plan and a 90% plan are tremendous. It's also worth noting that the 90% level is the platinum level under the Affordable Care Act. That is the highest measurement that the Affordable Care Act has when it comes to plan levels as to what the plan actually pays. The gold level under the Affordable Care Act is 80%. The silver is the current national average. So if you want to talk to your neighbors about what everybody else in America has for health care, I know they don't do what we do for a living, but the average health care plan in this country, the plan only pays 70% of the costs. The lowest level, the bronze level, is 60%, and there are plans out there that are much higher per month that only pay 60% of the point of service costs. The way these costs are changed is on the next slide, and these are the issues that would get you to that 90%. The best way to look at this chart, if you look at the current, the out-of-pocket, the co-insurance goes from 5 to 10%, but here is your protection. Your out-of-pocket maximum is only for an individual going from 1,000 over the life of these two-year changes to 2,000. So if somebody tells you your exposure is $10,000, that's not the exposure in this contract. You already have a certain level of exposure. The increase in that exposure is what we've negotiated here. In a worst-case scenario, if you go to the doctor a lot, and this is an in-network calculation, your out-of-pocket max would go from 1,000 to 2,000. And your deductible, which does not count towards the out-of-pocket max, would go from $200 to $350. That's roughly $1,350 worth of exposure in an annual period for an individual. But again, we're talking about an increase in compensation in the first 2 years of the deal of $18,000. There are only, according to the numbers that were, I think, the latest, 97% of the people in this plan have never hit the annual out-of-pocket max. And if you were not hitting the out-of-pocket max, it's unlikely that you would in the future. It doesn't mean you will not, but the numbers show that the bulk of the members do not hit that number. The in-network side of this, obviously, is the best place to get your benefits. It always has been. The out-of-pocket maxes for out-of-network coverage have always been twice as high, and they would remain twice as high. And if you jump between out-of-pocket or out-of-network coverage and in-network coverage, you have to run these clocks separately. So that is, if somebody comes to you and said they had a high annual cost, it's more than likely because they moved in and out of the two different types of coverage. We'll jump to the next one. This is how your co-pays would change for in-network medical treatments. Convenient care clinic changes nothing. It's $10 now. It would be $10 going forward. The co-pays on these different types of coverage are built on the plan cost. The cheapest place for you to get your coverage is at a convenient care clinic, if you can. The telemedicine that we're adding is the same contribution, co-payment. The $10 would apply to it as well. Primary care physician goes from 20 to 25. Specialist, 35 to 40. Urgent care, 20 to 25. And an emergency room goes from 75 to 100, but here's why. The average primary care physician visit costs the plan $150. The average emergency room visit costs the plan $1,500. A lot of the discussions we've had over the last 2 years are driven by the high cost of healthcare across the board. Doesn't matter what plan you're in, doesn't matter what job you work, the cost of healthcare in this country is driving so much of what we're talking about here. The question again, if you were to go to a presidential emergency board and complain that your copay went up $5 and it's still lower than what the congressman is paying, do we have an audience that we can go to get a better result is the primary question here. On the script side, there are certain changes to your drugs and on where you'd get your meds. Retail generic is still the cheapest for the single fill. It goes from 5 to 10. Retail brand is 25 to 30. Retail brand non-formulary, 45 to 60. Mail ordered is still your cheapest place to get your drugs because you get a 90-day supply. So if you avail yourself of a 90-day mail order generic, it goes from 5 to 10. You would pay that 4 times a year instead of 12. Mail order brand goes 50 to 60. Mail order brand non-formulary goes 90 to 120. The other issue that some of our other friends, I'll call them, in a different union are arguing that are of not importance are work rules. On my railroad, on BNSF, I think they've served over 50 Article 9 notices in the last 2 years to change their operation. They got the rights to do that out of arbitration award 458, a government settled contract. So we're not going to change the rules that are already in place. We're trying to preserve the ones we have. We're trying to prevent the railroads from getting equally onerous new rule changes through a contract. And if we go to a PEB, there are several work rule changes that will be on the table. We're going to go through them. But this is one of those things that's not in the contract. There's none. No work rule changes. It was said by others that I would sell my soul to protect our work rules, and I will say yes to that. I will. Work rules equal money, guys. Work rules equal not having to do more money or more work for less money, because that's what these work rule changes would do if they get their way. We'll run through what they are, because these are back in play if we go to a presidential emergency board. They want the right to impose automated job selection and placement. On CSX, the BLET already has that in place. UTU does not. This would allow them to serve notice and impose it any way they want it. No negotiation. No trades, no benefits for us. They could just impose it and adopt the version they like. They would also have the right to impose self-supporting pools. Some properties, that's called a Robinson rule, a chain gang, take your turn with you, to where if there's five guys ahead of you on the pool board and they all lay off, you're now first out. It would deplete your engineer's extra board, basically eliminate the guaranteed boards, and the pools would support their own vacancies. This is a job killer. And it also would make a dramatic impact to your lineups. They also want the rights to impose regulation of the pools based on starts rather than miles. If that's done appropriately, it's not a problem. If it's done the way they've proposed it, they could do whatever they want, and they will determine how fast you work or don't work. They have demanded the right to broaden enhanced customer service rules. Currently, those can let them change yard start times. They can run through terminals. This would let them basically destroy the separation of road and yard by using the enhanced customer service rules to get direct access to any given customer. The last one on the list would basically eliminate the distinctions between road and yard in the following way. They want the right to get you to either get or leave your train at least 25 miles on the wrong side of your terminal or the next station whenever they feel the need to have you do that. They claim that would let our guys get off the train early. But in application, you would pull it into the terminal, gas it up, and take it another 25 miles, in some cases, on someone else's seniority district for no additional compensation. This is more work for no pay. We have several railroads who have agreements on this now, and they get either 50 miles or a day's pay to do it. This would let them impose the new rule and take away the pay that we currently receive. So if any other union tells you that work rules are not important, having lived through 85 and 91 where we got slaughtered on work rules, because of PEB 219, we did not see a raise for 5 years. There's several people with gray enough hair in the room to have remembered it. That is when your basic day went from 108 to 130 and through freight. Every time we got a 3% raise, we had to run 3 more miles to get the day's pay. Totally ate up the raise. 5 years without a raise because we put work rules on the table. Didn't have a choice. We had to go to a PEB then. This is not the time to take these issues to the government, guys. That's really not, I think, going to enhance the outcome of this. We'll also talk to some of the work rule changes they have for our sister unions and our coalition. They want some dramatic changes in how the shop crafts do the work on in the shop floor. It would basically blur the lines and allow one craft to do another craft's work, which is a job killer. They also, on the BRS side, are Sigelman Brothers. Here's kind of an ironic twist. They want a rule that allows maintenance away to do the BRS's work out on the ballast. And we have maintenance away people out there telling BRS to vote no and take this to a PEB. Not a good idea to throw these kind of questions in front of a government. It brings us back to the fact that the panel that President Trump appoints will not necessarily understand your pay rules or your work rules. Do you think the panel will know what it's like to run through a terminal? Do you think they'll know that you have guaranteed extra boards and you don't want to be on a chain gang? If they don't understand how we get paid and how we work, the risk is quite high to put these questions in front of a government panel. With that, we're going to jump into just an example here before we go into questions. As I told you guys, in 1991, we went to a PEB. George Bush Sr. appointed that PEB. It was 219. The recommendations were so bad that we did not vote it. We started a 30-day cooling off period. We went on strike, and I believe, if I can read the small print, it was on the 17th of April. If you go to the next screen, Tom. This is the authority that the Congress uses and the language they used with less than 24 hours when that strike started. Congress adopted this resolution and said that we threaten the essential transportation services of the United States. We'll go to the next one. They included the national health and defense because essential transportation is part of that. They referenced that a PEB had heard this dispute the previous May. They discussed the issue, the recommendation that was issued January 15th of 1991, that we were unable to reach an agreement. Go to the next one. That's when they said that all the procedures provided under the Railway Labor Act had been exhausted, and there was no contract reached as part of that. And if you go to the bottom, the Congress, under the Commerce Clause of the Constitution, has the authority and responsibility to ensure the uninterrupted operation of essential transportation services. This is what Congress uses to write your contract, guys. If we do not do a voluntary settlement, this is what the Congress will use to do that for you. And as I said before, they will have the unfettered right to adopt the panel recommendations, write the contract themselves, and impose anything that they want. There is no recourse at this point under law. There is no challenge. There is no resolution to go seek a different outcome. You are stuck with what the Congress gives you. As we found out in 1991, it took us a lot of years to get over that. The 96 contract that followed that was a voluntary agreement. The tone of the railroads had changed. But if you were railroading in the 80s and 90s, the industry went through a lot of change, and it's back doing it again. So the question before the group is, do you want to put the risks that you have, knowing what they are financially, in front of this Congress, or do you want to ratify a voluntary agreement?